honestly believe that anything that's important to the heart of God that Satan is going to try to attack and destroy. It is my belief that whenever God gave Moses and the children of Israel the Ten Commandments, he was giving it to them as a moral guideline for them to be able to follow. And not only for them, but as we've been looking at our series on the Ten Commandments, for all of us to be able to follow, to make our lives better. God reminded them in Exodus chapter 20, if you remember where we began, he says that he is the Lord thou God that brought them out of slavery, out of the place of Egypt. And so he has let them know that he is the one who's given them victory. God's also told them that in these Ten Commandments, if you remember, he says, one, that he is the Lord thou God, there is only one. And two, he says that you should not have any graven image that you're going to worship, bow down to. And three, he says to remember that you're to keep the Lord's name holy. Do not take it in vain. And fourth, he says this, he says, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. And then fifth, he said that we are to remember our mother and father. We should honor them. And that because of doing so, that we would be blessed and our days on the land would be long. And then six, he reminds them that they should not murder. And today we come to number seven of our Ten Commandments series. He says to them, he says, thou shalt not commit adultery. Now, let's put it in this perspective. Someone said the Ten Commandments are nothing more than what you should not be doing. And I would say this, is that the Ten Commandments, if you look at it that perspective, it seems like it might be a negative thing. But think of it in the positive. The positive thing is that you should honor the commitment that you've made to your spouse. Think of that way. The world today doesn't want to hear bad news, so let's make it a little bit easier to swallow. Honor the commitment, the marriage that you're in. The great thing about marriage is that God Almighty has blessed it in the garden, and that we know that with Adam and Eve, that he joined them together, and that it was the very first institution that God created. The second is the church. So to me, that the two institutions that God has honored in creation, marriage and the church, how many of you would agree that in this year you can look at it and all the years behind us that Satan, the enemy, the world is coming against it every single moment? It is. We're trying to redefine marriage, but I will let you know that no government subcommittee is what will define what marriage is. Marriage will always be, because God created it, between one man and one woman. Anything else that you want to try to make it is nothing more than a make-believe play show. You remember when you were children, you might used to play house, or when you were children, you used to pretend like you were the teacher. When you were a child, you used to pretend maybe that you were a doctor, or any of the other things that you used to pretend when you were a child. Well, if anyone tries to define or live in a marriage other than one man and one woman under the sanctity of God, it is nothing more than pretend. And today we're going to look at why marriage is important and why we should honor that. Now, our foundational text comes out of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, verse 6, and I'll be reading from the Holman translation. These verses I give you today should also be up on the screen, but I encourage you to still look in the Bible yourself. Search out the Scriptures. Some of you have King James, some of you have the ESV, some of you might even have the NIV, whatever translation you have, but today I'll be using the Holman translation. In Matthew 19, 6, it says then, so they are no longer two, but one flesh. And therefore, what God has joined together, let no man do what? Separate. Let no man tear apart what God has put together. So if in Matthew's gospel, where it says that two are become one, and let no one try to separate what God has put together, that would let me know this. Obviously, here in that text is that there is an idea that man will try to divide it, destroy what God has put together. I'll say this to you, there are some sick, perverted people out there that they will try to destroy marriages. The only women that they go after are married women. The only people that they would go after is a married man. It's as if there's a ring on the hand. It is a challenge. I'll let you know this today, is that that kind of person that God Almighty can get a hold of and straighten out, they can be forgiven. But we should not intentionally try to live that kind of life. Do you remember what Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 said? It said, this is why a man leaves his father and mother. There comes a time that you've got to grow up. This thing about, I'm going to live at home all my life. Well, that's not even biblical. You can live at home all you want to. It's not that you're going to sin and go to hell because you're living at home. But there comes a time you do have to grow up. Is it not? The Bible says there comes a time you have to put away your childish things. You have to put away your toys. You know, you might be a grown man, but still be in your mind and in your actions like that of a teenager or a child. If you're a grown man and you're married, there comes a time it says that you're to leave your father and mother and the bonds with his wife, and they become one flesh. Become one. It tells us when one hurts, the other hurts. When one happy, the other's happy. Marriage is no joke. Anyone can say amen to that? And marriage is not easy. If it was easy, then we would not have such a high divorce rate. And the sad thing is that even in the Christian church, that divorce rate is just as high as what it is in the world. The statistics are not wrong where it says that averagely up to 50% of marriages end in divorce. And it's not just marriages that just are quick Las Vegas type marriages, getting married by an Elvis impersonator. Now, if you got married by an Elvis impersonator, that's not a sin. But I'm just letting you know, if you want me to do your ceremony, I'm not going to do hunka hunka love and dress up like Elvis. That would be an interesting wedding. So whenever Mickey and Darlene renew their vows, that might be something you see. If you know Darlene, you'll know why I said that. The point I'm getting at is that you become one. And the vows that you make, the commitment you make, is an everlasting commitment on this side of eternity. Sadly, one of the things, and I've told Jessica that I really don't get all that excited nowadays about doing weddings, because after about 25 years of performing wedding ceremonies, that it's not a very good track record, because I've seen so many of these just fall apart. And so you don't want someone to rush into that. You want them to be serious about it. But the sad thing is, there's some people more serious about signing a note on a car, buying a vehicle, and doing more research on buying that vehicle than they are and making a commitment and marrying someone. That's sad, isn't it? But that's the world we live in. And so we know that this is God's will. It might not be the world's will. You know how easy it is to get a marriage certificate? You go down there to the Register of Deeds office, you pay your money, and you show your identification and do all of this, fill out some paperwork, and you can walk out the same day with the certificate. Now, we do have it that we have in the United States, a no-fault divorce, that within a year of separation that you can get a divorce. And I've made a statement that I think that if I was probably in a higher office, that I told someone, and they said, well, that would never work. I said, you know, if I was something like president, that maybe we ought to wait a year, that someone has to fill out the paperwork to get married, and then let's wait a year, and if you still want to get married in a year, then let's do it. If you got to wait a year to get a divorce, maybe we ought to wait a year to get married. And the reason why I say that is maybe we need to make the courtship a valuable tool. Maybe we take that 1 year saying, hey, let's take this year to get to know each other, get to love each other. And it doesn't mean you have to wait a year, but can you see what I'm saying? And when we rush into something. Now, I do know people, and even good Christian people, that only knew each other for a few weeks, got married, and they're still married and happily married over 50-some years. Now, that's not always the case. And there's people that grew up with one another. They get married and stay married a year, maybe. The point is that we need to know that we're entering into a serious agreement, a covenant. You know, God loves us, does He not? And He doesn't just love us when we're lovable. He loves us because he's made a covenant with us. And there'll be times that we're not lovable, but God has made a covenant with us as well. Now, if you turn over to the New Testament, to Ephesians chapter 4, and look at verse 2 and 3, it says, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, accepting one another in love, diligently keeping the unity of the Spirit with the peace that binds us. You see, that's the kind of commitment that you make when you look at that person that stands across from you, when you put a ring on their hand, when you say, I do, in sickness and in health, and good times and bad, when we have a lot of money or when we're sleeping in a little camper, we're going to be committed to one another. And when you go into marriage, you have to have humility and admit when you're wrong. Men, you're not always right. Women, you're not always right. There comes a time we have to be humble and be gentle and be patient and accept one another in a spirit of love. If you married your spouse and you think that they're supposed to be just like you, well, my friends, then that takes away the uniqueness of God. God has made us all different, has he not? I find it interesting. God sometimes puts people together to complete opposite. He'll put someone together that's an introvert, someone that doesn't like Christmas, somebody that doesn't want to, you know, joke and cut up all the time. And then he puts them with somebody that's an extrovert that is nothing but Christmas and nothing but joking and being silly. And he puts them together and God says, you know what? You need a little bit of this person in your life, that kind of spirit, and they need a little bit of your spirit in their life. Isn't it amazing when God does that? So when you look at your spouse and say, I wish you were different, understand, God made them the way they are. You fell in love with that person. And then we look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 14. It says, above all, put on love. Love is not natural. But you have to put it on, do you not? We put on love because there's times you will get upset. In marriage, there'll be times. People say, well, we've never had a disagreement the whole time we've been married. Really? Really, you've never had a disagreement? Okay, well, that's great. You need to go on a circuit tour and do marriage conferences. Because most people I know have a disagreement, have an argument at times. And it's like this. Your spouse sometimes will rile you up more than anyone else. You know why? It's because one flesh, and isn't there times that that happens? One flesh can get a little agitated. But it does not mean you stop loving them. And here it says in Colossians, it says that love is the perfect bond of unity. What will bring together one man and one woman in a perfect way is love. And it's not this type of eros. There's a Greek word, the eros love, meaning erotic love. There will be a time in marriage, yes, that there is that erotic nature of passion. But I will let you know this, as you grow older, the eros you realize is not all that important. You realize there's a bond there, even whenever you're not like you were in your youth. And then we look at Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10. It says, who can find an honorable woman? Who can find this type of woman, a capable woman? She is far more precious than rubies and gold, but more precious than jewelry itself is what it says. Meaning that this is someone that you should get hold of. If you can find men an honorable woman, then be with that woman. The far sad thing is that we go after what the eye desires. And realize this, friends, is that what you see on the outside can change overnight. I, years ago, went to go visit a friend and have known him for years. And every time I saw this person, I mean, they were always fixed up like they were going out to some type of fancy ballroom dance. And I went and I had to drop off something for them. And so I went and knocked on the door, and when I knocked on the door, they came to the door, and it was probably before lunch. The husband knew I was coming, and so I was just going to drop it off. Well, the wife came to the door. When she did, I asked, I said, is so-and-so home? And she said, Ken, it's me. I didn't even recognize the person. I honestly did not know them because I did not realize that they had been wearing a wig. They took the wig off. They had no makeup on. They looked completely different. I don't even think they had their teeth in. And so I didn't know that. I mean, honestly. And you know how embarrassed I was? And so I apologized. Oh, I'm sorry. I said, I must didn't have my glasses on right or something. You know, I come up with something. Well, I saw the husband. I was talking to him. And I said, man, I feel so foolish. I said, I apologize. I said, I didn't even recognize your wife. He said, what are you talking about? I said, well, normally when I see her, that I, you know, she looks a little different. He said, she still looks the same to me regardless. You see, what he was saying without actually saying it is that what I see is deeper than what the world sees. Are you getting that? You see, in school, a lot of times when someone, and I hear people say this, when someone says to their mom or dad or grandparents, oh, I'm dating someone. Someone might say, are they pretty? Are they cute? Are they handsome? You know, is that really the most qualifying area in which we are to see? Shouldn't we be asking this, are they a Christian? Do they love the Lord? Do they go to church? How do they act around their parents? My grandma would say something like this, are they a good person? How many of you know that it is better to marry a good person that might not be pleasing to the eye to some than it is to marry someone that could walk down a runway as a model but on the inside be nothing but disgusting? Looks fade, but an honorable person's doesn't. Next, 1 Peter 4:8. Above all, maintain an intense love for each other, since love does what? It covers a multitude of sins. Now, if we know that Satan is attacking our marriages, then we need, as the church, to make marriage important. We need to talk more about the value of a man and a woman being together. We need to talk more about how Satan will attack a marriage. We need to talk more about how Satan will go after them and put them in places to be tempted by someone else, a co-worker, or even a friend. We should never allow the world and Satan's schemes to overcome the sanctification of marriage. Marriage should be a sanctified union between a husband and a wife. The reason why is because God created it. One author by the name of Eric Wiggins, I was reading this week, he said the following. The number one thing a man should want for his family is to keep it together. Think of that. The number one thing you should want for your family is to keep that family together. But you know, marriages don't die in a day. It's a slow decay, is it not? When you hear someone announce that we're ending the relationship, we're getting a divorce, I can promise you that that did not just happen that day. It happens over a period of time which tears away at a relationship. But I've got good news for you. If you're sitting here and you've been divorced, God still loves you. I've got a good news for you today. Even if you're the reason that you are divorced, God still loves you. And I've got another good news for you today. Is it even though divorce is wrong and it's a sin, guess what? God says He can forgive you of that if you will turn to Him. He can set you new. You might be sitting here today and you're on your third, fourth, fifth, sixth husband. Or third, fourth, fifth, sixth wife. And you might say, well, Pastor, I've been divorced all those times. I have left the marriage. I've been unfaithful. But I will say this to you. Who you're with right now, be committed to them. And make a pledge to say this. My past is my past. What I've done in the past, God has forgiven. And I will be totally sold out, committed to this man or this woman. But you see, church, what happens is oftentimes when somebody is divorced, we look at them as a second-class Christian. That's not how God looks at it. God says to look upon a woman or a man with a lustful thought is the same as committing adultery. So you say, well, I've never cheated on my spouse, but have you ever looked upon someone with a lustful thought? It's the same as cheating in the eyes of God. Let me give you five, actually six areas in which I want to share with you really quick, if you're taking notes, that if marriage is under attack, what should we do about it? One, rebuild your foundation. If you're married, rebuild the foundation. What is your marriage built upon? If your marriage is built upon what you have, meaning your house, your car, your bank account, you don't have much of a marriage. You should love your spouse regardless if you live in a mansion or if you live in a single wide trailer. Does it really matter where you live as long as you have the love of that person with you? You should love your spouse regardless if y'all were having to ride a bicycle to work or if you have a limousine bringing you to work. You see, love is supposed to keep the bond, the foundation. And what is that love coming from? Knowing that we are loved from by Christ. Number two, when you get married, make sure when you do that you draw a line in the sand. And what is the line in the sand that you say? When you get married, or if you're married right now, look at your spouse at some point and say this: the word separation and the word divorce will no longer be part of our vocabulary. You see, you will get mad. You will have disagreements. And if the first thing you think about is going and clocking out of that marriage, then something's wrong. Who put that thought in your heart? It wasn't God, was it? If God honors marriage, then God doesn't want you to be thinking and talking about separation and divorce. That's the world. You draw a line and say, we're not going to do this. And when you do it, if you do bring it up, ask for forgiveness from your spouse and move on. Number three, your relationship, and this is going to be a little controversial, so I just want to go ahead and make a disclaimer. If I were to put like an asterisk beside this statement, I'll put an asterisk here and say that you can get upset with me at lunch. Your relationship with your children should never be more or have a greater priority than your relationship to your spouse. They shouldn't. You love your child or your children different than you love your spouse. But my friends, you love your spouse as comes before your child. There's too many marriages that have been hurt whenever a child comes into the picture, that more attention is put on the child. And yes, a child does need attention. It needs attention from mother and father. But you never put that child above your spouse. What's the problem now is that we have some parents that treat their children as if they're the ones they have to give an answer to. My friends, you need to understand at the end of the day, your child will grow up, your child will get in love, your child will get married, your child will leave mother and father, and you'll have that empty nest syndrome. So you better make sure you have established priorities while they're in the home, because when they leave the home, you're still there stuck, and I hate to use it that way, with the one that's your spouse. Let me give you another one. Your relationship with your parents should never be greater than your relationship with your spouse. I've seen marriages fail because a mother-in-law caused it to fail. That the mother-in-law had to give her 2 cents in every single thing that happened in a home and had to completely run that household. My friends, if you have a child and you're a grown person and your children are married, let them make the mistakes, but don't ever humiliate them in front of their spouse. Don't try to run their marriage. Don't let them do that. You remember when your mama or your daddy tried to run your marriage, you didn't like it. And so if you have a parent, now that doesn't mean that you're ugly to them, because what was the fifth commandment? Honor thou mother and father. But it does not mean honor thou mother and father and let them run your marriage. Put your spouse before your parents. Here's another one that you might not like. Don't have a friend that you're more intimate with, personal, I don't mean sexually, but don't have a friend that you will share more with than you would your spouse. There are people that have friends that they'll tell their husband something and they'll say, oh, wow, I didn't realize. Yeah, I told so-and-so that, told my friend that, you know, a couple of weeks ago already. You know who should be your number one confidant in marriage? Not your best friend. And if it is your best friend, that should be your husband or your wife. Nothing wrong with having friends. I encourage you to have friends. But make sure at the end of the day that you're not sharing something with friends that you're not sharing with your spouse. That is one way that Satan can cause problems. When you make the child the king, when you put a friend in the driver's seat of your relationship, or when you put a parent in charge of how you run your house. Okay, that was number three. Number four, learn how to talk to one another. It's important to talk to one another. What is talking? Talking's not hollering and screaming and throwing things. You might get loud at times. I'll be the first to admit to you that you don't want to be married to a pastor because a pastor talks loud. And there's sometimes I'm not even mad and I'll talk loud. And Jessica will say, oh, what are you upset about? I'm like, what are you talking about? Why are you so loud? I'm not loud. But then I realize I'm around so many older folks that I do naturally try to talk louder so that they can hear me. I had one person tell me years ago in this church to say, boy, you do some good preaching. I said, what about all the others? I don't know. I couldn't hear them, but you talk so loud. Trust me, I can hear you. But learn how to talk. Talk about your hopes. Talk about your fears. Talk about silly stuff. Sometimes I'll send Jessica little jokes. And they're corny jokes. I mean, I'm talking about they're just ridiculous. And she's like, this is funny to you? I'm like, it's hilarious to me. I'll say something to her. I'm like, Jessica, did you get that phone call from the library about the overdue? And she's like, phone call from the library? What are you talking about? I said, well, you got fine written all over you, girl. Some of you will get that later. See, that's what I'm talking about. Corny jokes. That sounds like something David Connor would say to his wife, right? Amen. Fifth, become friends again. Some of you are married to someone you say, well, I love them, but, you know, I'm really not friends with them. It's hard to live under a roof with somebody you're not a friend with. How do you become friends again? I'm glad you asked. Go to the first place you took them on a date. Another one, and if it's biblical now. Okay, so I had to clarify that because I looked around and I saw some of you like, oh yeah, I can go back to that. Visit the spot that you proposed at. I can take you right now to the very location at Fort Fisher that I proposed. Listen to your favorite song together. What does all these things do? It rekindles something that caused you to what? Become friends and later become lovers. Six and final for today. This might sound so childish, but I think it's important. Return to the kitchen table. What does that mean? You know, we live in a time with TVs almost in every room in the house. Nothing wrong with that. But it's important maybe to get together and sit down at the kitchen table and turn the TV off, put the cell phones down, and just enjoy a meal together and just be in the moment. That's one thing that my wife and I really, we had to just completely make a decision to do, is that we put the phone down. And sometimes when we break that rule, I have to say, hey, I broke it. And I'll be the one a lot of times that does break it. But we have to do that and make a conscious decision to return to the kitchen table and love one another and sit there and just enjoy a meal. So we leave here today with that idea of counseling tips. But the two things that we should also, and it's greater than all of this, is that one, we make prayer a priority in marriage. If your marriage does not have prayer, then my friends, it will struggle. Marriage is hard. But you know what? You can survive what comes your way. Make prayer a priority. Second, on biblical concepts, make church a family activity. Do you know how much it breaks my heart to see where a wife will go to church and leave the husband and kids home? Or a husband will go to church and leave the wife and kids home. Or even in today's modern society, that the kids will go to church and leave mom and daddy home. Make church a family activity. Church does not supersede your family. It doesn't come before your family. Now, God does, but church doesn't. Church activities, no. But what you do is that you make that part of your family. Enjoy coming to church. Enjoy being part of that. I'm ready to get back to a sense of normalcy at church, aren't you? And when we do, I'm not stupid. I understand that there will be people that were coming on a regular basis that in the year of not coming, they probably will not return. I'm not crazy in thinking that they're going to come back. My granddad preached, and at the time I didn't quite get it, that there would be a day that there would be a shaking of the tree and dead leaves would fall off. I believe I'm living in that day right now. Some of your marriages might have been shaken. Maybe you've been shaken by bankruptcy. That can hurt a marriage, but you know what? It doesn't have to end. Get your financial house in order. Money can be a real danger in marriage. Too much or even too little. Amen? Let me give you another thing before we close in prayer. Well, Pastor, my spouse and I are right now contemplating divorce because I've just discovered that my spouse has had an affair. Did you know that you do not have to get a divorce because your spouse had an affair and cheated on you? You don't. You could be like the story of in Hosea. Hosea was married to a woman named Gomer. Now, that's an interesting name in itself for a woman, but he was married to a woman named Gomer who actually had an affair, cheated on him, and probably had children that were not his. But God said, forgive her and take her back. Now you say, well, Pastor, my spouse did have an affair, but they left me for that other individual. I will say this to you. You are not going to be held accountable if you've offered forgiveness to that individual and you offer to take them back and forgive them of that sin. Does not mean that marriage is going to be completely bed of roses for that day on out. It'll still be hard. But I will say this to you, is that if that person will not return, then you need to just say, God, Satan seems to have won this, destroyed my marriage. You forgive that person for having an affair, committing adultery, and you move on. You ask God to strengthen you and move on. Amen. Because it will happen. You will have some of the best Christians you know, some people that study the Bible daily, that even know how to read Hebrew, that their spouse would cheat on them and have an affair and leave. But you know what? We need to love that person and say this, God loves you for what you've been through, and God can still honor you in the days ahead. But you know what we ought to also say to that person who had the affair? God still loves you. God can forgive you. God can restore you. It might not restore your relationship with the one you divorced, but God can restore the relationship with you and Him. And isn't that important? Today, I know this might have been not the kind of sermon that you wanted to hear, but I believe it's the kind of sermon that we need. Why? Because the church is under attack, but isn't marriage under attack also? Let's pray.